guys ready up there? Are you ready up there? It's time for announcements. I'm going to start with one that may already be obvious. The Spiritual Life Committee will be the leaders of today's service. I'm Alice Angney, for those that don't know, and I have done a quick survey, and I think there are three people who I cannot name in the church right now, so probably everybody does know who I am. The Spiritual Life Committee gave Ramin today off. He is heading to Texas for 2 weeks with his family, and we gave him the gift of an extra Sunday for which he did not have to write a sermon. So he's here, but without the awesome responsibilities of a sermon. And the Spiritual Life Committee chair, Marilla, asked her faithful husband, David, if he would do the sermon. I think it has another name in here, Witness, today. But we are in for a treat, folks. So there are announcements on the back of your bulletin. Who else has an announcement that would help us help us start our worship? Yes, Meg.
Hi everyone, Megan Canella here with an announcement from my husband Mark. If you feel like getting dirty today, why is that funny? Sometimes I like getting dirty. We're harvesting our carrots and beets from Mark's garden. We have separate gardens. And they all are being donated to the food shelf. So if you want to help out with that harvest, it's at 1 o'clock this afternoon, and we're at 2883 County Road, which is about 1.7 miles north of Morse Farm on the left.
Okay. Sally?
The battery is low on this mic, so I hope it is still working. This afternoon from 1 to 3, the parish house will be open for people who want to pick up maps and do a driving tour, a history driving tour of the county. And also at 4 o'clock, Alistair Frazier and Natalie Haas will be singing and playing right here in the church.
Katie. Wait for your mic, please, Katie.
Not enough coffee this morning. Katie Gustafson, one of the two co-chairs for the chili auction. The announcement is in your bulletin, but Heidi and I have gotten a little behind schedule this year, so in about 2.5 weeks, we need to have a chili dinner organized and all of the donations. So if you've been a donator in the past and you're interested in doing so again, Heidi would love to hear from you. And I'll be in touch trying to get about 8 chilies and some salads organized in the next week or so. And we'll hope you all can be there. November 2nd, what time is it at? The time isn't listed. I think it's 6 o'clock in the parish house. It's really a lot of fun. If you haven't been before, please do think about joining us. Thank you.
Janice.
Hi, I'm Janice Waterman, and we had a chicken pie dinner yesterday that was a true community event. Diana and I co-chaired it, and there were so many people who either baked apple crisp or peeled squash or took reservations, washed dishes, helped serve out. It was really a wonderful event. I must admit we're all pretty tired this morning, but we raised over $3,000 at this event yesterday. And so it was great.
Ramin?
Hi, this announcement's actually on behalf of Emin Primo. I'm gonna read it, but I forgot my glasses, so I apologize if I get off track here. There are concerts Friday, October 27, 7:30 p.m. at St. Augustine's Catholic Church in Montpelier, Sunday, August 29 at 4 p.m. in Warren Church in Warren, and then Scragg presents Sacred Songs of the Marys, a program of ecstatic and contemplative early and early inspired music that connects back to the Divine Mother Mary and Mary Magdalene. Scragg co-artistic directors Mary Bonhag and Evan Primo are joined and celebrated with classically trained musicians, sound healing practitioners, and founding members of Anonymous Four, Ruth Cunningham. They're doing it on the works of Hildegard of Bingen, Kathy Watson, Eddie, and others. The program includes a world premiere chant by Cunningham based on the text from the non-canonical Gospel of Mary Magdalene. Sounds of Transformation will be having a concert Saturday, October 28 at 2 to 3:30 p.m. here at the old meeting house. This workshop will be also led by Ruth Cunningham and will introduce practices of humming, toning, as well as singing chants and songs. So if you're interested, please come and support our two amazing musicians.
I have an announcement. I see Maureen Carr in the back of the church. I believe that this is just beyond her 1 year anniversary of her stem cell transplant, and it is so good to have you back worshiping with us. We have Tim Noonan up here with me this morning. It's nice to have company. It's nice that it's Tim. And he has a special announcement for us.
Thank you, Alice. I'm happy I didn't have to say that about Maureen. So I'm here today in my role as moderator for a special announcement. Our beloved co-pastor, Rona Kinsley, has informed the executive board that she will be retiring at the end of December. It's a joyous occasion. We talked about that at the executive board. In accepting Rona's retirement, the board expressed deep gratitude for the many years of spiritual leadership and guidance Rona has provided to the old meeting house. We were first graced with Rona's presence in 2009, so 14 years ago, when she became interim pastor upon Susan Cook Kittredge's departure and shared pastor duties with David at the time. Rona provided invaluable stabilizing leadership during what turned out to be 3 years until OMH called the Reverend Alyssa Junk as our new senior pastor. 6 years into Alyssa's tenure, Rona returned to OMH as part-time associate pastor to form a wonderful partnership with Alyssa. When Alyssa departed in 2019, thankfully for us, Rona stayed on and shortly thereafter assumed the role of soul pastor to guide us through the stormy waters of COVID. When Ramin was called in early 2022, Rona joined him as co-pastor and was a valuable mentor to Ramin as he became familiar with his new position. In recognition of Rona's immeasurable contributions to the old meeting house, the executive board has conferred on Rona pastor emerita status. Need to emphasize, the status is not accompanied by any responsibilities. So Rona can enjoy a full and real retirement. Although Rona will be fully retired, we are pleased that she and Brent will continue to be with us as active members of the OMH community. We all will have the opportunity to express our gratitude and best wishes more fully to Rona as we will honor her on one of her favorite days of the year, Star Sunday, on January 7th. So now I know Rona would like to say a few things to us, so I'll turn it over to her.
I've struggled with this decision over the past few months because I love this congregation. I've loved being in ministry with you. And you really are the place of my heart. But I was also aware that my energy and my passion for ministry had just diminished to the point where I didn't feel I could do the kind of job that I wanted to do, to feel good about myself as a pastor. I will be 75 in April, and it's time. Time for me to step back. Ramin has told me he's fully ready, and I believe that this is deeply so, and that we honored that at his installation. He has just lived into and grown into this role in a beautiful way, and I feel that you'll be good and we'll be fine. So I just want to express my tremendous gratitude to this community for all of these years of ministering together, and to the executive board for the immense honor of the Pastor Emeritus status, which, as Tim emphasized, bears no responsibilities, but allows Brent and me to continue to be members of this community and to be among you and with you, and just to keep enjoying our time together. And as a member of the congregation, you can relate to me as you would relate to any other member of the congregation. We can have conversations, we can do things together, but anything of a pastoral nature, I will refer to Ramin. And I guess that's it. Thank you.
Well, what you need to know, Rona, is you're making me cry. This is wonderful for Rona and Brent. I can only tell you that retirement does have just a lot of advantages over years and years of responsibility. And I'm so happy for the two of you, you particularly, Rona. But I'm sad for us. Welcome, everyone, to the Old Meeting House community, which, through the wonders of technology, stretches far and wide. We are an open and affirming church with a diverse congregation where all people are needed and wanted. When I am standing in our beloved Old Meeting House pulpit during the welcome, I almost always end by saying, "This is God's house, and all are welcome here, today and every day." What technology additions helped me to realize is that God's house is everywhere, and she welcomes each of us and every one of us every day. Please join me now in a few moments of centering silence to prepare us to focus on the messages that we will hear this morning. Oh, we should have a prelude, shouldn't we? as soon as we get through the silence. We are going to extend this time of focusing on God and our morning's worship by now having our prelude. I think perhaps I was channeling Rona. I remember a service, one of the times that Rona restarted here, when I believe it was the prelude that slipped out of the order, the exact order. And Rona's excuse, and a very good one, was that she served many churches as an interim, and the liturgy was not always the same. I have no such excuse. I just didn't read my paper very well. Listen to the call to worship. May the Spirit of love guide us as we worship today. Be with us, O God, and help us to be with you. Help us to use this sacred space, this thin spot, to listen carefully to you. Open our hearts and minds, and all hearts and minds, to the work that needs to be done to make the world a place where all people are safe. Please join me in listening to today's introit. God, thank you for this gorgeous sanctuary, your house and ours, where the doors are open to all and hearts search for meaningful ways to serve you. Thank you for this day and the people gathered here physically or through technology. Thank you especially for the Reverend Rona Kinsley and for all the years of love and support she has given to the Old Meeting House community. May her next chapter in life bring her much joy. At this time of unbelievable chaos and terror, help us to step back from a global conflagration. Help us to find ways to turn hearts from hate to love, and this world from terrorism and war to peace. May we find hope, courage, and strength in each other and in you. Amen. Our opening hymn is Shadow and Substance, number 398.
Our responsive reading this morning is Psalm 106, which can be found on page 692. I will read the odd verses if you will read the even. Praise God, oh, give thanks to God, for God is good, for God's steadfast love endures forever. Who can utter the mighty doings of God or declare all God's praise? Happy are those who observe justice always, who do righteousness at all times. Remember me, O God, when you show favor to your people. Help me when you deliver them, that I may see the prosperity of your chosen ones, that I may rejoice in the gladness of your nation and glory in your heritage.
Remember me, O God, when you show favor to your people. Both we and our ancestors have sinned. We have committed iniquity and have done wickedly.
They made a calf at Horeb and worshipped a cast image. They forgot God, their Savior, who had done great things in Egypt.
Wondrous works in the land of Canaan, and awesome deeds by the Red Sea.
Therefore, God said God would destroy them, had not Moses, God's chosen one, stood in the breach before God to turn away God's wrath, that it not destroy them.
Amen. Thank you.
Susan, are you doing the First Testament reading? Okay. It's all good. First, I have to find it. Let's see. Isaiah 5:48. It's on page 548, Susan. No worries. We're starting, it's 25, 1 through 9. Perfect.
From Isaiah, here we go. O Lord, you are my God. I will exalt you. I will praise your name. For you have done wonderful things, plans formed of old, faithful and sure. For you have made the city a heap, the fortified city a ruin, the palace of aliens. Therefore, strong peoples will glorify you. Cities of ruthless nations will fear you. For you have been a refuge to the poor, a refuge to the needy in their distress, a shelter from the rainstorm, and a shade from the heat, when the blast of the ruthless was like a winter rainstorm, the noise of aliens like heat in a dry place. You subdued the heat with the shade of clouds. The song of the ruthless was still. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wines, of rich food filled with marrow, of well-aged wines strained clear. And he will destroy on this shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of his people he will take away from all the earth. It will be said on that day, no, this is our God. We have waited for so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. Hear what the scripture is saying to you.
And Susan, the gospel reading is 22, 1 through 14, and it's on 803. Thank you. This is the time in our service when we share our prayers, our joys and concerns, that we might all join together to hold them in prayer. Are there any joys and concerns to share today? Ramin.
I just want to express my gratitude to Malcolm and Diana, Alan and Barb, Richard, Alice and Amy, Janice, Mary Redmond, Catherine Cerulli, all the people who helped out yesterday to make the chicken pie such an amazing success. I mean, Linda Queto was there. She did a great job. Deeply appreciate all the hard work that went in, but also how much fun you made it seem. You guys are amazing, and I think we all owe you a debt of gratitude. Thank you.
Hannah.
Hi, I have two. One is we're welcoming Martha here from Germany. She's with a group of German students for 10 days, so welcome to Martha. And the other is that my mom and Tim finished the Camino last week, and now they're relaxing in the Azores by doing things like hiking down into old volcanoes. So we wish them safe travels home at the end of this week.
Kathy.
I have prayers of joy and gratitude. My son got married on Friday, and it was a wonderful celebration and good to see all our family that I haven't seen in a long time. And I just pray for blessings over him and his wife, Casey. It's Nick and Casey and their new blended family. Thank you.
Julie, I have a prayer.
Yeah. Hi, I'm Mary White. I'm a relative newcomer here. I've been in a rough patch the last couple of weeks, and I'm just grateful to so many members of this church who have helped me. Nancy Vachon, Susan Riley, Ramin, David Connor offered help I didn't accept that day. But you wonderful people, thank you.
Go for it.
I'm Laura Brown. Is it working?
If you put okay, yeah. So I just want to thank everybody for their prayers and say that Bud, my friend from Georgia, made it up that 1,100-mile drive, on a lot of it on a terrible Interstate 81. And so I just want to welcome him here now that he's here and made it safely. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Welcome back, Bud. David, can't see you behind the pipe there.
I know, that's how it works every week. Prayers of gratitude for Rona's leadership always, but specifically during the time of the pandemic. The announcement this morning made me think about week after week of trudging to church, stopping along the way to pick up a broken computer again and again, and still drawing us all together and keeping this community strong no matter what.
And
I'd like prayers of gratitude for the fact that we live in such safe and loving embrace of the land and of the spirit. And I'd like also to notice how much of the world does not live under those circumstances, and pray for mercy and peace.
Sally.
Prayers for Eric and Selena, who are undergoing some tests, and hope for strength as they go through the next few years.
Rona.
Once more, prayers of gratitude for this community, for all the ways in which you are wonderful. But on a much more personal note, last winter I asked for prayers for my older grandson, who was really struggling with huge school anxiety, not wanting to go to school, just everything was tanking horribly for him. And this year, this fall, as a new middle schooler, he is loving school. So the change of school, the change of scene, whatever it was, I am so grateful. I can hardly stand it. And so just prayers of gratitude for him, and prayers for all kids who struggle in school, that they might find the teachers, the support staff, the parental support, whatever it is they need to have a better experience.
Diana.
As many of you know, I worked with Marion Palmer for years, and Janice and I can now say she was right there with us yesterday. Her name was mentioned many times in that kitchen one more time, and it was just a joy to continue Marion's tradition. And over the 50 years that I have worked on that thing with her. I also had a special blessing yesterday, and many of us are experiencing this these days, as we get to see people we have not seen for years, And there was a young man that came up to me in the kitchen, and he said, hi. And I looked at him, and I could not visualize who I was looking at, but he was the first young man that I took care of as a child care provider, and he's now in his 50s. And let me tell you, I felt like heaven had dropped on my shoulders for him to search me out after all those years. Thank you.
And I would just like prayers of gratitude for the life of my, oh my goodness, I guess we started in kindergarten, school friend who passed away recently of a heart attack. And prayers for her family, Kathy Baylert, from Cranford, New Jersey. Thank you.
Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for all that you provide and the blessings we receive daily from you. We know that at times we feel hopeless amid so much uncertainty in our world, but we trust you to bring peace and give us comfort when we are overwhelmed. Help us to be calm in the chaos around us and give us the strength to overcome. We lift up prayers for the homeless, the hungry, the lonely, the rejected, those left behind, and all those who are suffering injustice in our community and our world. Hear their cries for healing, wholeness, and acceptance, O loving God. We ask that your Holy Spirit accompany and protect all those who are dealing with violence and hatred. We pray for continued strength and courage for all who are being persecuted by society. Let us not be afraid to stand boldly and to speak against all hate and violence. God, you call us beloved even when we stand in the face of violence and fear. Please help us to continue to be agents for transformation and equity. Help us all to live according to your call to love one another as you love us. Help us to show mercy and offer compassion and forgiveness to all. Gracious God, we pray that our hearts be open to the change that needs to happen here on earth so that all creation may sing your praises. Help us to see each other as gifts from you. We pray this with confidence that you are walking with us and guiding us. Mold us into the vessels you want us to be, full of compassion and hope. We come to you in silence that you might hear the words that we have left unspoken. Let us join together in the words which Jesus taught, saying, Our Mother, Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Open my eyes that I may see. Here is the truth of God's word. I send my hand to a wonderful.
All good gifts around us come from you, O God. As you have given us gifts, so we offer these gifts that we might be gifts unto each other. When we give from our abundance, we proclaim our trust in God's provision and our love of neighbors. The offering shall now be given and received. God, we share this offering in hope and trust that through these gifts we might be a channel for your peace. Amen. Our hymn of preparation is number 332. As we gather at your table, please rise as you are able and join me in song, except you're already standing, so. Thank you.
The New Testament reading is from the book of Matthew, chapter 22, verses 1 to 14. The parable of the wedding banquet. Once more, Jesus spoke to them in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his slaves to call those who had been invited to the wedding banquet, but they would not come. Again, he sent other slaves, saying, 'Tell those who have been invited, look, I've prepared my dinner. My oxen and my fat calves have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet.' But they made light of it and went away, one to his farm, another to his business, while the rest seized his slaves, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged. He sent his troops, destroyed those murderers, and burned their city. Then he said to his slaves, 'The wedding is ready, but those invited were not worthy. Go therefore into the main streets and invite everyone you find to the wedding banquet.' Those slaves went out into the streets and gathered all whom they found, both good and bad. So the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to see the guests, he noticed a man there who was not wearing a wedding robe. And he said to him, 'Friend, how did you get in here without a wedding robe?' And he was speechless. Then the king said to the attendants, 'Bind him hand and foot and throw him into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen.'" Thus ends the reading.
Cast out into the harsh desert by choice, seemingly immune to the hot winds, swirling dust, and steady parade of onlookers, the artist stood behind a 5-foot sculpture of a small child, staring directly into the mouth of a 35-foot long, 16-foot high, 7,000-pound monster, constructed of a welded steel frame coated in upcycled tires, heat-blackened steel scales and teeth, and 10 bright glowing resin eyes. As they reflected on this culmination of several years of work, 50,000 fundraised dollars spent, and a lifetime of childhood sketches brought to three dimensions, trucked from a warehouse in Santa Fe to the desert of Nevada, Tigre, Bailando, Mashal, Lively hugged their sculpted child. A mirror image of the child itself was illuminated within the mouth of the beast, and the recorded audio within the sculpture whispered to Tigre, "I believe in you." I can only hope Tigre heard the message for what it was, but we won't know. 3 weeks later, a year ago this month, Tigre ended their own life, leaving behind an intricate and devastated web of friends, family, and artists all shocked, but few truly surprised. When I think about that one man showing up to a joyful party, out of dress code, and cast out into the darkness, Tigray dances right back into my mind. Tigray Bailando Mashal Lively came into this world as Jamie Lewis Marshall Lively in 1985 in Philadelphia. And Jamie Marshall Lively came into my life in 1998 while I was working as a 20-year-old camp counselor at a small Quaker camp in southern New Jersey. I was in charge of the oldest boys' cabin, a group of 14-year-olds still searching for their true selves while desperately attempting to assert their place as big fish in a tiny pond. In many cases, they also celebrated and mourned the end of 10 years well spent together at a simple, dirt-filled, wooded haven that few knew about, living as shoeless, barely clothed heathen outcasts in plain sight, hidden away from the latest encroachment of South Jersey McMansions by an ever-thinning line of pine trees. Now, Jamie was different from the beginning. They came to camp for only 1 year, seeking respite from bad habits being rapidly forged in the city, and from their incredibly loving, yet exuberantly intense mother, Linda. Linda, in turn, was seeking a few weeks of respite from Jamie, who was beyond skillful at rebuking her attempts at lovingly redirecting their life choices with harsh words and increasingly shocking actions. Jamie arrived quietly, clad in dark clothes, spiky metal jewelry with bright blue hair, recently dyed for the occasion. Now, instead of this appearance having the distancing characteristics they perhaps sought, the response from this small group of pretty cool, non-conforming Quaker youth was to welcome Jamie instantly, seeing right through to their kindness, their passion for art, and absolutely loving their blue hair. One evening, tired from a throng of younger campers, mainly girls, chasing after Papa Smurf, as they quickly dubbed him, Jamie asked if they could stay behind in the cabin for evening activity and rest and draw. "Are you going to do anything unsafe, stupid, or illegal?" was my question. And Jamie assured me that was not the case, and went on to include that if I granted that request, they would not do anything that would interfere with what they guessed were my own plans to do stupid and illegal things with my colleagues after the kids went to bed. This kid was brilliant. And what ran through my mind at that moment was, I have to introduce Jamie to my sister. My sister's also Jamie, and also sported bright blue hair at the time. She was a year older, too old to return as a camper, too young to return as staff. Both Jamies shared a passion and love for art, a disdain for conformity, and the rules for the sake of rulemaking. While Jamie Marshall's behavior at school and attitude toward their mother somehow earned them a space on a local news Kids Out of Control featurette, Jamie Schilling had become enraged with high school culture interfering with her right to become educated on her own terms. She requested transfer to a county alternative school where students learned independently and was informed that that school was for troubled kids, mainly those on a short pathway to expulsion and not a place for honor students who played the cello and just wanted blue hair. My sister swiftly promised the assistant principal that she would return to school every day with a knife in her hand until she did meet the criteria. And she earned the privilege of being cast out of high school into a learning environment where she was, by all accounts, very successful. The two Jamies met during a day in which my sister came back to visit camp, and with the assistance of a few kind, yet incredibly unprofessional counselors, they were able to sit up all night talking about art and being teenagers outside of the norms of the world. They became inseparable, dated for several years, supported each other's art and social justice projects, and they truly loved each other. And when the intensity of their own pathways drew them in different directions, they remained close, with Jamie Marshall proudly serving as a master of ceremonies and artistic director at Jamie Schilling's wedding 10 years after they first met. Shortly after that time, Jamie Marshall began their transition to Tigray Bailando, becoming immersed in the artistic scene of the pre-corporate Burning Man community.
and further embracing and embellishing the qualities that set them apart from mainstream society. Tigray's true leap of faith was becoming a full-time artist. Their body became intertwined with their art, and the image of a beautiful individual making beautiful sculpture on the desert playa seemed to be Tigray's truest essence. Indeed, their life was dedicated to artistic creation, unabashed self-expression, and social justice, including the founding of Santa Fe's Earthseed Black Arts Alliance, focused on centering and amplifying Black voices in northern New Mexico, as well as collaborating with indigenous artists. Despite this development of self and commitment to inclusion, Tigray constantly felt so deeply excluded from the world itself, often referring to suicide since their early teenage years in the coded language of leaving this world to travel to the next realm of being. Walking through the world as a tattooed, pierced, genderqueer, Black, Jewish, Iraqi artist, Tigray saw no shortage of communities with unwritten dress codes, eager to cast nonconformists out into the darkness. In August of 2021, a 21-foot-tall sculpture of Tigray's, billed as a queer and Afrofuturist expression of comfort and solace, was burned to the ground by arsonists less than a month after being commissioned by a Santa Fe public art gallery. 6 months prior to that, an altar created by Tigray to honor the intersectional struggle for liberation and well-being by the Black and Indigenous communities of Santa Fe and New Mexico at large was also defaced by vandals several times before being eventually deinstalled. Now, when your being is at the core of your art, the message is clear. You are not welcome here. Jamie's early tests as a misbehaving teenager, pulling away from the world to check for a lack of belonging, were validated to Tigray by the very worst elements of our society. And what does that have to do with the parable of the wedding banquet? I say absolutely everything. It's clear that the wedding party itself represents the marriage between God and humankind. Many traditional interpretations stem from a cautionary tale of avoiding self-righteousness as a barrier to enter the kingdom of God. Beware, nonconformists. Keep your head down and fit in. Worse yet, this parable has been used as a means of coaching believers to walk the walk, with a penalty for not following the rules of the venue, written or unwritten, being eternal exclusion from love and comfort. Make no mistake, this is a powerful means of human control, directly opposed to Jesus' own teachings. Come to me, all you are wearied and burdened, and I will give you rest. Come, all you are thirsty, come to the waters, and you who have no money, come buy and eat. Come as a child. Now, why would someone who built his ministry on unconditional acceptance, walking on the margins, imploring his followers to come as they are, use something as simple and exclusionary as being dressed improperly to demonstrate unworthiness for God's kingdom? I don't believe he would. The parable says nothing about the state of the man's heart, his morality, his convictions. It simply tells us that when he showed up with the wrong clothes on, likely too out of place and too scared to verbally defend himself, he was assaulted and banished. So perhaps the parable of the wedding banquet is a warning to those of us who proclaim radical welcome every day in Jesus' name, that we still have room to grow. What are the unwritten dress codes of this space? And how might we unintentionally exclude someone from the blessings of God's love before they even walk inside to hear the words of welcome? Friends, this is by no means to suggest that we are by nature an exclusive congregation. We see evidence every time we meet that we certainly are not. But it is to assert that radical welcome is an ideal that will always require work and reflection. And maybe it even goes farther. From most angles, Tigray's fear beast sculpture blasted recorded messages of negative statements. You are worthless. standing behind the child triggered a change, with an inner child within the monster beginning to glow as the audio shifted to the positive messages. I believe in you. You are welcome here. The sculpture highlighted that within the beast, there is a wounded inner child that is often the source of destructive and damaging words and actions. So perhaps Jesus and Tigray are reminding us that our very human nature is an imperfection, in which our own fears, our own sins, our own wounds may put us at risk of either becoming the king, practicing exclusion inadvertently while seeking to throw open the doors, or becoming the person cast out, unaware of the unspoken and unjust codes of the world around us. As we look into the mouth of our own fear beasts, seeing the very best of ourselves, sometimes at the core of what we all fear, may we be reminded that through all of humanity's challenges, there remains a loving God calling to us, ever speaking and whispering, hopefully loud enough to be heard above the din of the world, that we are truly loved. And in this place, in this world, and in this moment, we belong. In that, true radical welcome is God's to offer, not ours. May we spend our lives studying and amplifying the call, letting God speak through us to the very best of our abilities, imperfect as we may be. Now, will you please stand as you are able and join us in our closing hymn, number 584, verses 2, 3, and 4. Friends, go with such strength. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect.